Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio this afternoon is Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letters RTS during the relevant question. I call question number one, Cocab Stewart.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to support community gardens.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We recognise the benefits community gardens can bring to the well-being of individuals, bringing communities together and improving local biodiversity. And this year, we're providing £100,000 to Green Action Trust to deliver the Growing Food Together Fund. 8 community food growing projects will benefit from the fund, which aims to increase the land available for community growing and to improve food growing skills, empowering communities and individuals to grow their own food. Community growing projects have also benefited from an investment through the Empowering Communities Programme, with a further £3.7 million from the Vacant and Derelict Land Investment Programme, and that will support directly support 6 growing projects.
Cocab Stewart.
The Greyfriars Biophilic Community Garden in my constituency has been shortlisted for the Evening Times Community Garden Champion Team Awards later this year, with the winners being announced on December the 5th. With projects involving the local community improving primary schools, a community garden has been a force for good for the local community. Does the Minister agree with me that community gardens provide significant improvements and wellbeing benefits, and Greyfriars is a shining example of what can be achieved involving the community?
Minister.
I absolutely do agree. I'm absolutely delighted to hear that Greyfriars Biophilic Community Garden has been nominated for the Evening Times Community Champion Team Awards, and I wish them all the best in that. I'm sure the garden's a wonderful place. I'll put that on my list of gardens to visit, and it's an excellent example of the huge range of benefits community gardens can bring, including but not limited to increased nature-based volunteering opportunities and education. Communities up and down the country are already reaping the many benefits of community gardens, which, as the member says, includes significant environmental and wellbeing benefits, and I wish them all the best.
A supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to put on record my thanks to James Barnes, David Lydiate and Stan Green for hosting an amazing gardening and horticultural CPG just outside here in the Parliament last week. And we discussed in the CPG the need for horticulturists, for gardeners and farmers for the future generations. And I just wondered how the Minister and the Government could support skills and training to contribute to in those sectors.
Minister.
I had a really good discussion actually with Stan Green, and they had a stand in the corridors of Parliament as well around horticulture, and it was great to meet him, and it sounds as if the CPG was great. I mean, our Vacant and Derelict Land Investment Programme demonstrates our sort of commitment to bringing sites back into use, particularly for horticulture. There's quite a good example of quite a number of these sites throughout the whole of Scotland. They can use the funding for whatever they actually want to do within that space, and that could include training as well. I mentioned in my response to Cocab Stewart the two streams of funding that are doing that. Of course, we're not just talking about equipment and plants and soil here. We could be talking about training as well, and it's up to those individual projects to decide how to use that money, but there's certainly money and funding available.
Question number two, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussion the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the development of rural skills to help deliver its commitments in relation to peatland restoration and the programme for government 2023-2024.
Minister Lorna Slater.
Training and retention of a skilled rural workforce is critical to deliver peatland restoration targets. A variety of skills initiatives are underway, including on-site demonstration days, a newly launched training course, a new entrance initiative, and training on Public Contract Scotland's tendering. Rural skills were included during a discussion of the Ministerial Working Group on the Rural Delivery Plan. This meeting was attended by the Deputy First Minister, Cabinet Secretaries for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, Skills and Education, Transport Net Zero and Just Transition, myself and other ministerial colleagues. My officials are now increasing efforts to expand our work in this area going forward, including using existing links with other ministerial responsibilities.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank the Minister for this answer. The programme for Government 2023-24 outlines plans to restore 10,700 hectares of degraded peatland over the course of the next year. It also outlines plans to progress action with crofters and Scottish ministers crofting estates to support further peatland restoration. Can the Minister advise how the Scottish Government is measuring the restoration of peatland and ensuring maintenance of its unique carbon catching properties across Scotland's rural lands?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for his interest in this topic. We are absolutely ramping up our progress towards achieving our targets in peatland. We've increased between 2023 and 2024 our restoration of peatland by 40%, and then again 2022-23 increased by 35%. So this is something that is significantly ramping up. Nature Scott, for example, are delivering activities through their peatland skills plan and supplier development programme to assist small and medium enterprises to tender for this work successfully. And we're putting in place a range of training opportunities focused on key crofting areas in the Western Isles, Shetland, Sutherland and Skye.
Supplementary, Major Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In recent weeks, we've heard both the Justice Secretary and the Environment Secretary talk about the need to include peatland restoration in plans to bolster natural flood defences. Now, the Minister talks about ramping up peatland restoration. Of course, the SNP and Green Government is well behind on its targets to meet peatland restoration. But will the Minister ensure that farmers and land managers are included in the Scottish Government's flood resilience planning as we move forward?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for that question. I've come into the chamber today to answer a question around how skills development in peatland restoration works, but I'm very happy to write to the member with the answer to his question about including farmers in managing flood plains through peatland. Thank you.
And supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The peatland restoration industry is in its infancy, and there is likely much we can learn from the rewetting of peatlands that has occurred in countries like Germany, Poland, Lithuania and Latvia. Can the Minister say to what extent Scotland's peatland restoration industry is disadvantaged by being cut off from the skills and experiences of practitioners in Europe by this hard Brexit that we have now, which Labour now seems to support?
Minister.
It's clear that a hard Brexit has had a detrimental impact on our rural skills sector. However, the Scottish Government is alive to this risk and recognises that international cooperation is crucial in addressing the dual challenges of the climate crisis and biodiversity decline. We sponsored the Peatland Pavilion at COP26 to champion international cooperation on conservation, restoration and sustainable management of peatlands. Nature Scott are working with counterparts on the island of Ireland through their involvement in the Shared Island Fund, which is supporting, amongst other things, a new investment of €15 million in peatlands restoration that will benefit cross-border collaboration, knowledge sharing and expertise building.
I call question number 3, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much grant funding it provides directly to each of Scotland's botanic gardens annually.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
Scotland is home to many world-class botanic gardens, including the Royal Botanic Garden Edinburgh, which operates across 4 locations in Scotland. Now, the Royal Botanic Garden Edinburgh receives funding from the Scottish Government, as well as a range of other sources. And over the course of this current financial year, Scottish Government grant in aid to RBGE was worth £30.4 million.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Glasgow's botanic gardens have provided free access to generations of visitors for more than 180 years. Their benefits are huge, including for health and well-being. Recognising that, free access has been sustained for nearly 2 centuries. But like so many cherished facilities and vital public services, they don't seem to have survived SNP green cuts, with the Council now suggesting charges of £3 for an adult and £1.50 for a child. And I note that the Cabinet Secretary did not mention Glasgow Botanic Gardens in her answer. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what funding does she provide to Glasgow Botanic Gardens, and what is her view of charges during a cost of living crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, there are a couple of points in Pam Duncan-Glancy's a question there that I would like to address. Now, I mentioned specifically the Royal Botanic Gardens in Edinburgh and the four different locations and the fact that we directly fund them through grant and aid. But that's because they're a statutory body, a non-departmental public body, and that was set up and established through the Natural Heritage Scotland Act in 1985, which is why they received that grant and aid. So other than that, that's why I didn't mention Glasgow Botanic Gardens, because we don't directly fund these other bodies, and it's because they're a statutory body that they get that direct funding there. Now, I completely appreciate the member's points about free access, and I think the last thing we would be wanting to do is exclude people from green spaces, and particularly in our city centres as well. But again, we are in a really tough time at the moment in relation to our budgets. We're feeling it within the Scottish Government, and I know that local government is feeling that too. Now, there was an uplift in local government funding last year, and I would just come back to the point
you.
That in
Thank
relation
you,
to Glasgow Botanic Gardens.
Thank you, Minister. Minister, I will need to move on. Thank you.
Question number four is not lodged. Question number five, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it is taking to support farmers to protect crops, including from future flood-related damage.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
The Scottish Government places a high priority on supporting farmers to protect crops from a wide range of threats, including pests, diseases and adapting to the changing climate. Now, key elements include our investments in the Plant Health Centre and Farm Advisory Service, and overall we invest almost £50 million a year in the portfolio of strategic research to support advances in sustainable crop production, natural resources and the environment, and that includes research aimed at improving crop resilience. Now, in terms of future flood-related damage, I've seen and discussed firsthand the impacts on crops for farms affected by the recent severe flooding, and at the NFUS Autumn Conference on the 26th of October, I committed to working with the farming sector to bring forward support for the repair of flood banks damaged by that extreme rainfall during October, protecting our vitally productive farmland.
Jeremy Balfour.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that it's been widely reported that Scotland's farmers suffered extensively from flooding and storm-related damage during October, with the cost expected to run into millions. Therefore, will the Cabinet Secretary commit to a support fund and ensure that future food security remains a top priority in the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think what has been so concerning about this as well is that while there have been some immediate impacts, I think it's going to be a while before we are able to assess the full extent of the damage that happened after the recent flooding events and the recent storms too. As outlined in my initial response, I did outline some initial funding package and where we believe we can add the most helpful support at the moment. And of course, we'll be looking to consider any measures through the passage of the Agriculture Bill as it proceeds through the Parliament. I've been out to visit different farmers as well, saw firsthand the damage to some of the flood banks in Perthshire too, so I appreciate the seriousness of this and what is impacting some of our most productive land in the country. So it's vital that we work together to try and improve the resilience of our farmland going forward.
And supplementary, Rosa Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I agree with the Minister and indeed Mr Balfour in the need to compensate farmers for lost crops. However, could we involve farmers in offsetting flood water at the start of a flooding episode to stop damage downstream and make sure that that is properly compensated for and planned for in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think what is clear from all of this is that it's vital we work across catchment areas. I think when we've seen the recent flooding events, we need to consider that wider impact, what more we can be doing at various parts of the river. And I think it's that catchment level engagement, which will, of course, have to include farmers and land managers to see what any other potential solutions might be so that we can increase that resilience and we're able to adapt to what could be and what's looking like increasing flooding events going forward.
A supplementary, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As well as needing practical support to mitigate and adapt to climate change, we know that the impact of extreme weather also is emotional, with a toll on people's mental well-being. Farmers, as we know, face particular challenges with mental health and isolation. What more can the Scottish Government do to support farmers who might be struggling emotionally right now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Karen Adam raises a really important point, and as I outlined in one of my previous responses, I've been out to visit some of the farmers firsthand. I've seen the people and businesses within my own constituency too, and you can see that real significant emotional toll that events like this have on everyone, and as with our farmers, as well as the professionals and the volunteers who are involved in responding to these events and who are now involved in that recovery work too. Now, we can't forget that extreme weather events do have devastating consequences and really test people's resilience, and I think in acknowledgement of that and the effects of flooding on farmers and recognising that increased need, as Karen Adam mentions, for emotional, financial and practical support they might need now, as well as over the course of the weeks to come, I recently announced £50,000 of grant funding to RSABI to enable them to continue to provide the help and to bolster that support available through their own flooding crisis fund. And just to put on record my thanks to RSABI for all the incredible work that they're doing.
I call question number 6, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will help farmers to plan for their succession.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Gujon.
Scotland's Farm Advisory Service, which is funded by the Scottish Government, currently offers farmers and crofters access of up to £1,000 in funding for specialist one-to-one advice on succession planning. In addition to this, the Farm Advisory Service provides extensive guidance and advice with succession planning too. Additionally, the Scottish Land Matching Service, funded by the Scottish Government, acts as a free service, and it engages with those seeking or offering joint venture arrangements in relation to land. And by doing that, it then provides a platform for planning for succession for farmers and crofters who are wanting to take a step back from the business.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. As you'll be aware, many of Scotland's farmers are elderly and the younger generation are not attracted by the profession. Succession planning is essential not only for the future of Scottish agriculture, but also to ensure that we tackle rural depopulation. Will the Cabinet Secretary ensure that the commitment to farmers for the succession planning remains in place for the foreseeable future?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it is a really important point that the member has raised, and I'm really glad that she actually raised this question today, because it is something that we need to encourage our farmers, landowners and land managers to think about. And that's where I would also highlight that Scottish Land Matching Service does really valuable work in that regard. And they're also looking at, they're working with the Crofting Commission just now to have the succession discussion when it comes to crofting too. So I'm committed to us maintaining that support and ensuring that we do all we can to get our new entrants into the industry as well, because as much as there are challenges, this is a really exciting time in our rural economy. There is a strong future there, and I would encourage people to get involved and to think of this as a career of choice for the future.
And supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Excuse me. Farming is an intergenerational affair, and succession is often about custodianship and viability of the farm business in the future. And I can tell you, I was recently at the Dalmally Blackface Tup Sale. The place was full of young people desperate to get involved in blackface sheep breeding. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that Scotland's farmers are better served in this regard by the SNP's commitment to active farming and food production, and that the best thing the Tories can do to help farmers to plan for the future is to demand clarity over the future funding for agriculture from Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would agree entirely with that, because we need that certainty, we need that clarity from the UK Government about future rural funding after 2025, because beyond that point, we have no idea what funding we're going to receive. And of course, if we were still in the EU, not only would we have that certainty of funding, but we'd have it over a 7-year period and be able to provide that longer-term assurance. Now, of course, agriculture is devolved, and it's crucial that Scottish Government policies are unhindered by the threats that are posed by the UK Internal Market Act, the subsidy control regime and the lack of long-term replacement EU funds.
I call question number 7, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government how its agricultural development projects will boost organic produce and improve environmental practice as part of its work towards achieving its net zero targets.
Cabinet Secretary.
I am fully committed to supporting organic farming under our Vision for Agriculture, where we outlined our ambition for Scotland to become a world leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. Now, we've funded the role of an organic development manager with a key objective of addressing market opportunities domestically and internationally for Scottish organic produce, and that's included significant research into organic abattoir provision in Scotland, as well as then contributing to work on a small producers pilot scheme. Now, we are working with the organic sector to establish a new organic food and farming action plan to deliver that sustained growth of the organic market.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. On the back of the Deputy First Minister's recent visit to Marcel Farm in my region to highlight Scottish Government funding for the Scottish Organic Dairy Goals 2023 project, can the Cabinet Secretary indicate how the project can identify meaningful measurements of natural capital and carbon, as well as address issues relating to organic protein in central Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, just to say that I'm delighted that we've been able to fund this project through the Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund, because this project, amongst a range of other outputs, it's undertaking a series of carbon audits and soil analysis testing amongst the organic cooperative. So these tests are being discussed and being benchmarked across the cooperative with the support of experts alongside that to really explore the value that's there in conservation management and the potential marketable value in measurables. Now, they're having similar peer-to-peer support by hosting meetings on grasslands and on soils to optimise forage utilisation and homegrown proteins too. And the outcome of all this work is we're hoping to see across that increased confidence for informed decision-making on carbon efficiency, that natural capital management and organic proteins. And overall, the work that's being taken forward by this group should offer a more efficient, resilient and market-led Scottish organic dairy sector.
And supplementary, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A recent flooding has demonstrated how vulnerable Scottish agriculture can be to bad weather and exposed the impact that this can have in crop resilience, including in areas such as East Lothian and the Scottish borders. So will the Scottish Government now finally commit to kicking its political prejudices into touch and commit to the use of genetic technology as a means to bolster our future food resilience?
Cabinet Secretary, I think the question was relating to specifically organic produce and improving environmental practice, but perhaps in that context.
I've already outlined in previous responses again recognising the damage that's been done by the recent flooding, how important building that resilience is. I've outlined a number of measures we're looking at there, how we need to work with our farmers and land managers, so I do feel I've addressed that in previous responses.
Question number 8, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest, which shows that I was previously an owner of a private rented property in the North Lanarkshire Council area, and ask the Scottish Government what continued engagement it's had with the Scottish Land Commission about its proposal for compulsory sale orders since it first proposed them in August 2018.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government regularly engages with the Scottish Land Commission on a broad range of matters, and that includes recent discussions relating to the Rural and Island Housing Action Plan, which affirms our programme for government commitment to taking forward work in 2024 to consider the justification for and practical operation of compulsory sales orders, and particularly in light of our commitment to reforming compulsory purchase orders.
Mark Griffin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She'll no doubt be aware that there was a cross-party support, including from the government backbenches, on taking forward compulsory sale orders. And I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can give a timeline for delivering those potential new powers so that councils have that ability to really address the blight that those empty homes have on rural communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Mark Griffin does really raise an important point, and he's absolutely right. There is that, I think, cross-party support for considering this as an issue, and that's why we had the commitment within our programme for government this year to continue the work in relation to that. But the issue with compulsory sales orders is that it is a complex matter, and I think it's only right that we consider that alongside the view of compulsory purchase orders that's getting underway as well. So, as I've already said, the PFG commitment says we will continue the work on that this year, but of course I will be keeping Parliament updated. Happy to keep in touch with the member too as that work develops and progresses.
A supplementary, Kate Forbes.
Setting aside the fact that land reform is the latest subject of Labour U-turns, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that stifling of community progress by absentee landlords reveals just why that relationship between communities and the land must continue to be reformed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do agree, and I think the member raises a really important point. Absentee landowners, who are often really difficult to trace, represent a real substantial barrier when it comes to supporting communities to thrive. We know through all the community ownership that we've seen that community-owned assets have a real positive impact, both in rural as well as in urban communities, and that's why we are committed to strengthening that, encouraging that, and we are committed to continuing on our journey with land reform and to do that on an ongoing basis. Now, we have, of course, taken great strides in relation to land reform since devolution, and this government is committed to progressing further land reform legislation. We've already consulted on proposals, we've published the results of that consultation, and again, we will be bringing forward that legislation to the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs, land reform and islands. And there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio to allow front bench teams to change positions, should they so wish. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio this afternoon is NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care. Again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the Request to Speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function if online. And at question number one, I call Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for an update as to how its winter preparedness plan will aim to reduce pressures on the Scottish Health Service.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Winter plan, jointly published with COSLA on the 24th of October, sets out a whole system approach to respond to surges in demand for health and social care services and actions to relieve pressure points across the system. New funding measures include £50 million of a boost for the Scottish Ambulance Service to assist with recruitment and up to £12 million to expand hospital at home. This expansion will enable more people to be treated at home rather than in hospital and will deliver at least 380 additional beds this winter, relieving pressure on NHS wards.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. The additional funding set out in the plan for hospital at home is indeed very welcome and will no doubt reduce pressure on our A&E departments this winter. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about how the expansion of hospital at home will help people across Scotland, including my constituents, this winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, the additional £12 million of investment for this winter, which will provide for the expansion of hospital at home services, will assist constituents in the members' constituency and right across the country by providing additional capacity, particularly for a range of services, including children and people with respiratory conditions. This will help to support boards who are taking forward a range of initiatives to develop hospital at home within their respective areas in order to expand over the course of this winter. And the funding that we are making available to them will allow them to go ahead and to develop those services this month and into the winter months in order to provide greater capacity.
And supplementary from Sandish Gohani, who is joining us online. Dr. Gohani.
Thank you. And a declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. Dr. Donald McCaskill of Scottish Care says the Scottish Government's winter plan is not worth the paper it's written on. To quote him further, it says nothing, it gives no hope. And Rachel Cackett of the Coalition of Care and Support agrees with him. We now have Reform Scotland's recent report telling us that waiting times for hip operations are soaring, and the chair of BMA Scotland commenting we have a system bursting at the seams with a workforce running on empty. In light of all of this, how confident is the Cabinet Secretary that this winter patients are going to get the service they need and deserve, and that you can maintain social care, and that this will not be the worst winter on record again?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, there's a range of measures that we've taken forward with our winter plan. One, we started its development earlier this year, and we've taken a partnership approach to its development. That's why it's a joint whole system approach with COSLA to meet some of the pressures which we know and expect within our health and social care system going forward. We also engage with the social care sector in the development of the plan. And of course, the additional investment of some £50 million in our ambulance service and also the additional £12 million in expanding hospital at home are all part of the package of measures that we're putting in place to help to try and meet the demand that we'll face over the course of the winter months.
And supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
The Cabinet Secretary will have seen the troubling statistics yesterday that show increased waiting times in A&E, delayed discharge rates, which are sky high, and the level of cancelled operations up again. And this is only autumn. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us how much his plan will reduce A&E waiting times by over the winter period? And will his plan also eradicate waits of over 12 hours?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely, Officer. The plan, as Jackie Bailey will be aware, is to try to help to meet some of the challenges which we'll face over the winter months. I haven't hidden from the fact that A&E performance is not where we'd want it to be. A big part of that is because acuity rates are greater, and also we have numbers of people who are staying in hospital for longer periods than previously was the case, with hospital occupancy levels at a greater level. All of these will present challenges, which is why very specifically the interventions that we have with additional funding is to try to help to reduce and manage some of that demand over the course of the winter months. I can't quantify exactly what it will help to improve it by, because we don't know what the demand will be over the course of the winter, and we don't know what the full pattern of demand will be over the course of the winter months because of the varying nature of winter illnesses. But what I can assure the member of is that we're determined to try to do everything we can to support the system through what we know will be a very challenging period, both at a health and social care level, which is why we've taken a whole systems approach in partnership with COSLA on its development.
I call question number two, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported planned closure of Erskine Park Home.
Minister Marie Todd.
Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership and the Care Inspectorate are aware of the planned closure and they've met with the provider. We know that the National Care Home contract has been cited as the reason for this, and we're sympathetic to the rising cost of specialist care. But we do understand that Erskine is offering all residents the opportunity to move to their veterans village that's very close by should they wish to do so. Regrettably, there will be situations where the independent sector or local authority-run care homes close. It's out with the remit of the Scottish Government to intervene. Our focus is on ensuring that local partners who are responsible do what's required to ensure transition to suitable alternative placements.
Neil Bibby.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Erskine, the charity for veterans, provides fantastic and specialist services to many older people in my region, and this closure will clearly be disruptive to residents. If a charity such as Erskine is having to make such a difficult decision because of the challenging financial situation it and other independent care providers are in, can I ask the Minister how the Scottish Government will ensure there is adequate funding in place for the whole social care sector to ensure staff are well paid, people are kept out of hospital and looked after so they can receive the appropriate and quality care that they need?
Minister.
So the member will welcome the fact that social care funding has increased by over £800 million compared to 21-22 as part of a record high health and social care budget of more than £19 billion. We've made a commitment to increase in the course of this Parliament the spending on social care by a quarter, and we're ahead of trajectory on that. We continue to work with partners to address the pressures that they face and to take forward reform to deliver improved and sustainable services. On social care workers' pay, those delivering direct care and commissioned services will see their pay increase to a minimum of £12 an hour from April next year, up from the £10.90 minimum rate introduced this year. The creation of a national care service will help to provide consistency and further improve paying conditions, access to training and development, and ensuring a career in social care is attractive and rewarding. And we are beginning to make those improvements now.
Question number three, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what steps are being taken to increase recruitment and retention of staff in the Scottish Ambulance Service this winter.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has provided £50 million above baseline funding to support the Scottish Ambulance Service this year. This investment supports ongoing work to recruit 317 frontline staff, helping to increase capacity to respond to emergencies. This includes 18 additional clinicians working in the integrated clinical hub, who through additional triage can offer patients alternative treatment routes, reducing the number of hospital admissions. To support retention of staff, the Scottish Government invested £568 million in the NHS Agenda for Change 23-24 pay deal, ensuring that NHS Scotland Agenda for Change staff remain the best paid in the UK.
Jackington Barr.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The £50 million in funding announced in October to support recruitment in the Scottish Ambulance Service is very welcome and will play an important role in ensuring that the service is prepared for the winter months ahead. Will the Cabinet Secretary join me in recognising the incredible efforts of our ambulance service, particularly during the busy winter period? And can he say any more about how this investment will help support increased demand?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely, officer. I would join Jackie Dunbar in paying tribute to the incredible work that's carried out by our ambulance staff throughout the course of the year, but particularly during the winter months when we see demand at its peak. The £50 million of funding, which I announced last month, will assist the Scottish Ambulance Service to further develop its demand and capacity work in order to help to continue to build on the additional staffing which they've been recruiting over the course of the last couple of years. As a result of an additional investment over the course of the last few years, they've been able to recruit 1,388 additional staff since 2020. I can also advise the member that the Scottish Ambulance Service is working to recruit staff within the ambulance control centres and clinicians to work within its integrated clinical hubs, which help to guide patients to the most appropriate community pathway where that is applicable, reducing what is unnecessary
Thank
admissions
you,
to
Cabinet
hospitals.
Secretary, I need to move on to the supplementary, which is from Tess White. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, the £50 million is welcome. However, a Freedom of Information request has revealed that more than 850,000 hours of overtime was worked by SAS staff between April 2022 and July 2023 at a cost of £24.4 million. Recruiting ambulance service staff takes time and onboarding them takes time. So can the Cabinet Secretary promise our overworked ambulance staff that they will receive better support this winter than they did last winter? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, that's why we're providing them with additional funding to recruit more staff and also to provide additional clinical staff within the clinical hubs to support paramedics on the ground when they're dealing with patients. So that's exactly what the purpose of the funding and additional staff capacity is for.
I call question number four, David Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to improve the detection and treatment of estimated 1.3 million people in Scotland living with high blood pressure.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Our Heart Disease Action Plan and Stroke Improvement Plan both include the aim of minimising preventable cardiovascular disease by improving detection, diagnosis and management of risk factor conditions such as hypertension or high blood pressure. The Connect Me programme delivers a national pathway for high blood pressure diagnosis and management. The pathway is already used in every health board and by most GP practices in Scotland. Evaluation has shown it's having a positive impact on reducing blood pressure. It's enabled more than 85,000 people in Scotland to remotely monitor their blood pressure, contributing to improved blood pressure control.
David Torrens.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Data from the Scottish Health Service suggests that only one quarter of the people with high blood pressure are treated to target. With high blood pressure being associated with around 50% of heart attacks and strokes, will the Minister commit to prioritising the action of high blood pressure to reduce the burden of ill health it causes for the people in Scotland?
Minister.
Absolutely. I mean, I recognise the importance of taking action to tackle risk factors like high blood pressure in order to minimise preventable cardiovascular disease. That's why, as I said in my initial response, we've already prioritised this by including actions to improve the diagnosis and management of high blood pressure in both our Heart Disease Action Plan and Stroke Improvement Plan. And if I highlight, for example, in our Heart Disease Action Plan, it supports community models of detection, although it is important to note that such efforts should be aligned with clear referral pathways for further investigation and clinical advice.
I call question number five, Liz Smith.
To To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the winter COVID-19 vaccination programme.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The winter flu and COVID-19 vaccination programme began on the 4th of September and will run until 31st March, with the majority of vaccinations completed by 11th December to ensure maximum protection over the festive period. At the midway point of the programme, uptake is strong. As of 29th October, over 810,000 COVID-19 vaccines, along with over 1.2 million flu vaccinations, have been administered. Getting vaccinated is the safest and most effective way to protect yourself and the NHS this winter, so if you're eligible but yet to book an appointment, I would encourage you to do so.
Liz Smith.
It's a very encouraging answer, Minister, in terms of the numbers and the uptake. I'm asking the question, however, because I have had representations from quite a few constituents that they don't feel that the information provided about the time when they will be eligible for the vaccination is being sent to them. And I wonder if you could have discussions with NHS Scotland just to ensure that that information is as clear as possible.
Minister.
I thank Liz Smith for that question and would agree that the information sent has to be absolutely clear. And yes, happy to speak to my officials about that.
Question number six, Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of the Scottish Mental Health Law Review on the legal status of autistic people in relation to treatment and involuntary detention.
Minister Jenny Minto. Minister Marie Todd, excuse me.
Thank you. The Scottish Mental Health Law Review recommended making changes to the Mental Health Act whilst retaining provisions covering non-consensual care and treatment. As part of our Mental Health and Capacity Reform programme, we'll work with partners to consider these proposals, and in particular the definition of mental disorder, to reach a position on who should be within the scope of the Mental Health Act. This work will be undertaken alongside the development of a proposed Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodivergence Bill to enhance and protect the rights of people with learning disabilities, autistic people and neurodivergent people.
Maggie Chapman.
The Minister will be aware that the current definition of mental disorder, as outlined in the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003, incorporates autistic people. Whilst the Scottish Government's commitment to work with partners on definitions in the space is welcome, the recommendations of the Scottish Mental Health Law Review of that autistic people continue to fall within the scope of the Act is not. Given that autism is a lifelong neurodevelopmental difference, not a mental health condition, does the minister agree with me that autism must be removed from the scope of the Act as part of the promised reforms? And will she commit to working with partners to deliver this much needed change?
Minister.
The issue of the definition of mental disorder within the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003 is complex and sensitive. I absolutely recognise the concerns of many people with a learning disability, autistic people and organisations who advocate for or on behalf of them. I can confirm that scoping work has already started within the Mental Health and Capacity Reform Programme to consider this issue, including plans to engage with stakeholders. It's too early at this stage in the programme to establish whether autism should remain in scope of the definition. There is significant work needed to inform that position.
Question number seven, Miles Briggs.
The Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the ability of children living in temporary accommodation to access health services, in particular in relation to current levels of treatment for mental health services.
Minister Marie Todd.
Everyone should receive the best possible care and treatment from our health services, including mental health services, regardless of whether they are living in temporary accommodation. Children living in temporary accommodation can access local GP and mental health services, including CAMHS referrals if appropriate. CAMHS is available for all children and young people who meet the agreed referral criteria in Scotland. For others, community-based mental health support might be the most appropriate form of support. We're providing local authorities with £15 million per year to fund community-based mental health supports and services for children and young people.
Miles Briggs.
figures show a total of 2,265 children living in temporary accommodation here in the capital. It's little wonder that Edinburgh City Council last week declared a housing emergency. I've been supporting and working with a number of families living in temporary accommodation who have been unable to register with GPs here in the capital, with many GPs operating closed lists and therefore telling families to go to accident and emergency to access health services. Can I ask the Minister, what review has been undertaken to look at children living in temporary accommodation and what health services are actually available to them? And if not, will ministers agree to urgently undertake this review?
Minister.
So I'm not aware of a review that has been done. Obviously, my area of portfolio is on mental health, and I can assure you that children are able to access CAMHS even when they are staying in temporary accommodation. There are statutory obligations on local authorities to assess the needs of the household, not particularly the needs of the children, but to assess the needs of the household, and that does encompass assessing their health needs. If there is difficulty in registering with the GP, as Miles Briggs narrates, obviously the Health Board has a role in ensuring that everybody can access general practice services, and should he have examples where that hasn't been the case, I'd be more than happy to take that up with him outside of the chamber if the member would just happily write to me and furnish me with the details. Thank you.
Supplementary, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. An important strand of ensuring accessible mental health services to young people is through a high standard of community-based mental health support that the Minister referenced earlier. So can I ask the Minister to provide an update regarding the steps being taken by the Scottish Government to support community-based mental health?
Minister.
So the £15 million annual funding that I previously referred to has enabled local authorities to put in place over 300 community services across the country for children, young people and their families. Local authorities report that more than 45,000 people accessed these supports in the second half of 2022. The services are focused on prevention and early intervention and include supports for positive mental health and well-being, as well as emotional distress. Our easy accessibility is an absolutely core principle of the community services, and many of the supports are accessed through self-referral.
And supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Members across the Chamber will be familiar with young people who have struggled to access mental health support. And this Government did make a commitment that 10% of NHS expenditure would be dedicated to mental health, yet it's a target that has still not been met. In fact, it's currently £180 million adrift in cash terms. So how can this Minister justify that and ensure people can access mental health services when they are so far off this target?
And of course the focus of the question is those children living in temporary accommodation.
Absolutely. I'm happy to take the question though. So we've made a commitment in this term of Parliament to ensure that 10% of the entirety of the health budget is spent on mental health, 1% of that on CAMHS. What you have seen from this Government is whilst there are real challenges undoubtedly remaining, we are seeing really positive signs of improvement in CAMHS. So the waiting list for first-time appointments has been reduced by almost a third in the last year. Children waiting over 18 weeks has decreased by two-thirds in the same period. The national performance against the 18-week CAMHS standard is the third highest achieved since the quarter ending June 2017. And of course the medium wait time for CAMHS services is 11 weeks. That means that way more than half of the children who are referred for CAMHS appointments see their CAMHS specialist within the 18-week target.
And question number 8, Alexander Burnett.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made on eliminating long waiting times for NHS patients.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are working closely with NHS boards to reduce long waits and to deliver on a commitment in our £1 billion NHS recovery plan to increase inpatient, day case and outpatient activity. In each of the next 3 years, we plan to provide NHS boards with £100 million to help to reduce inpatient and daycare case waiting lists by an estimated 100,000 patients and deliver year-on-year reductions. We will work closely with NHS boards and stakeholders on a number of key actions which will see patients treated as quickly as possible. 2023 is also a milestone year for the NTC programme, with NTC Fife and Highland opening in the spring and NTC Fore Valley and the completed extension of NHS Golden Jubilee will open later this winter.
Alexander Burnett.
Answer. Now, patients are waiting years for NHS treatment, including one in NHS Grampian, waiting 6 years for surgery. Another constituent who was hospitalised with gallstones in March 2020 is still waiting for a gallbladder removal. He's in significant pain, suffering regular attacks resulting in hospitalisation and vomiting for up to 12 hours at a time. He also has had to take off significant time off work, causing financial difficulty for the family. This backlog is having devastating impacts on people across Scotland. So in addition to what the Cabinet Secretary set out, what concrete plans does the Scottish Government have to ensure that health boards are able to reduce waiting lists and my constituent will receive his operation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed officer, I recognise the concern that the member's raised on behalf of his constituent, and I deeply regret someone having to wait an extended period of time for the treatment that they clearly require. Obviously, the decision in terms of priority is a clinical decision, but the member will recognise that a significant backlog of elective work has developed as a result of the pandemic, not just here in NHS Scotland, but across the UK and globally. We can see the impact that's had on healthcare systems. And in the member's challenge to me about what specific action are we taking to address it, as I outlined, we are investing an additional £100 million over the course of the next 3 years, in each of the next 3 years, in order to make sure that we see sustained reductions in waiting lists across all speciality areas. That's a funding priority we've made because we want to make sure that we see waiting times reducing for individuals like his constituent, and that investment over the course of the next 3 years will allow us to treat an extra 100,000 people through the NHS.
And I have received requests for 3 supplementaries, and if we have brief questions and answers, I could squeeze all 3 in. Supplementary, Arvin McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The role of technology has a key role to play in increasing capacity to clear NHS waiting lists. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how many NHS operations were carried out last year, how many of those were carried out using robotic surgery, and how the Scottish Government plans to increase this number going forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we've provided in the region of £20 million to support the introduction of robots, and we now have 16 in operation across NHS Scotland. Last year, there were 230,000 NHS operations, which is data provided by Public Health Scotland. And of those, some 3,180 of these procedures were undertaken by robot-assisted surgery. We also have 90 trained surgeons and a variety of different techniques operating across the system to help to make sure we maximise the potential benefits in terms of clinical outcomes for patients from new technologies such as robot-assisted surgery.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For children waiting on lists for clinical operations, waiting months can feel like years. So what's the Scottish Government doing to reduce child waiting lists?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I recognise a wait for anyone for an extended period of time is not acceptable, which is why we're investing an additional £100 million in each of the next 3 years to see sustained reductions in waiting lists across all specialities. And that includes with where it's children who are waiting for procedures. That will allow us to increase the number of procedures by 100,000, and it will see sustained reductions in waiting times right across all the different speciality groups.
Supplementary, Cara Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Reduced access to community health facilities and increased pressure and workload placed on community midwifery teams has led to me being advised in terms of in-person appointments, and I quote, that many women do not meet their named midwife until 22 weeks of pregnancy in Ayrshire and Arran. This wait is far too long and is of significant concern. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Government is working with health boards to eliminate long waits for pregnant women looking to meet in person with their named midwife? And can he advise if the Government has explored asking health boards to formally record the length of these waits per case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I don't want to see expectant mothers waiting unduly long periods of time to meet with their named midwife. And if there are specific issues within Ayrshire and Arran, I'm more than happy, if the member wants to be provided with the details of that, to look into the matter and to try to identify what actions could be taken to address the very concerns that the member has raised.
And in fact, I've got a late entrant here, a supplementary from Craig Hoyth.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In September, only 6 in 10 A&E patients in NHS Lothian were seen within 4 hours. What does the Cabinet Secretary have to say to those 4 in 10 patients, often waiting in pain for many hours or more than a day? Surely it has to be more than sorry.
Cabinet Secretary.
Absent officer, it is more than sorry, and it's the actions we're taking to try to help to address these issues. As I mentioned earlier on, I'm sure he was here for the earlier part of portfolio questions about expanding hospital at home with an extra £12 million being invested in that, which is on top of the £3.6 million we announced earlier this year to see an even more rapid expansion of the service, and also providing an extra £50 million to our ambulance service to increase their capacity to see and treat as part of our winter resilience programme.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on NHS recovery, health and social care, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change position should they wish. Thank you.